everyone. I'm very happy to be here today because I get to give a talk about these two. Wait, no, sorry, these two. DevTools and Headless Chrome, and how we can combine them to automate things on the web. My name is Yonatan Mevorach. I'm a web developer from Wix.com. I have two kids along with my amazing wife, whose name, and I swear this is true, is Git. So when we talk about web automation, the first thing that usually comes to mind is applying it to testing. So we want to provide a good user experience in a consistent manner. So what we do is whenever a new feature comes along, we write a test for it, which is essentially an automated script. And we run all those tests every time we want to release a new version to production. And if all those tests pass, then it's on to production. So if the feature is about exposing a new bit of UI, it's about exposing a new user interaction that the user is able to do with our app, this is fairly well established. You use a framework like Selenium, an end-to-end testing framework. You use code to describe how the user is going to interact with the DOM, and then you use code to make an assertion about how the DOM is going to change, and that's how you conduct your test. But if the feature you're working on is a more technical feature, it's not about exposing a new piece of UI, it's about making the site have better performance or security or accessibility, well, how do we test those kinds of features? So that's what we're going to focus on today. We're going to try to see if we can extend the limit of what you can test yourself without being dependent on some third-party tool. And the example that we're going to use to illustrate this later in the talk, we're going to assume that we just completed some feature that's going to make our site a bit faster. And now we want to write a test for it. So if somebody accidentally reverts what we did a week from now, a month from now, a year from now, we'll get an immediate alert. We'll be able to fix it immediately. And the user won't have to suffer as a result. But ultimately, this technique that I'm going to cover, it really has nothing to do with testing, per se. It's more about the ability to automate anything that you do manually in whatever workflow you have when you're doing web development. So you could apply this to other things as well. It's really up to your needs and your imagination. So headless browsers, that's what we normally use when we're doing automation on the web. Headless browsers are regular browsers, but instead of controlling them with a mouse and keyboard, you control them via code. And instead of rendering anything to the display, they render things in memory, which makes them really suitable for automation. And up until recently, the undeniable king of headless browsers was Phantom.js. But today I want to talk about a new player in this game, and that's Google Chrome. But not Google Chrome the way you and I use it every day, but rather Chrome running in headless mode, which is a new feature that was released in Chrome 59. And now the ability to run Chrome in headless mode and create automation with Chrome is really officially supported by the Google team. Now, along with the headless Chrome, Google also released a companion library called Puppeteer. Puppeteer is meant to be a high-level wrapper for controlling headless Chrome. And it's just a node library, so you can just grab it off NPM. And let's use an example to kind of show how it works and how it can be beneficial. So let's see an example of another common use case for automating things on the web, and that's extracting data from a website. So let's say that I want the data from the schedule page for RenderConf. I want it in a nice consumable JSON format so I can interact with like the Google Calendar API or something like that. So how would I go about doing that with Puppeteer? So the first thing you do is you would require Puppeteer, again, just a node library. Then we're going to call puppeteer.launch. And under the scenes, this will take care of launching headless Chrome for us in the background. It's running in its own separate process. It's not running inside of Node or anything like that. But that's going to take care of all that communication. And notice that I'm using the await keyword here because all the actions that I'm doing are asynchronous. Then we're going to call new page, which is essentially the same as opening up a new tab in our headless browser. Then we're going to go use the goto method to navigate to the schedule page. Now, in order to actually extract the data from the page, there are several ways to do this. But the one I'm showing here is using the page.evaluate method. And what that takes is a function. But this function that it takes as a parameter is not executed here as part of my node script. It's actually serialized and sent across and executed in the scope of the headless browser. So that's why here you can see I'm using DOM APIs like document query selector all. That's because it's not happening here in Node. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to find all the time slot elements and the session start and the title for each session, grab their value. All of this will evaluate to the array that I want later in JSON format. And that's going to be executed on the Chrome side, serialized and sent back and made available as part of my node script. Then I can do whatever I want with it. And in this case, just log it out. And then I can close my browser. So that's Puppeteer. As you can see, it's pretty straightforward and easy to get started with. So now let's talk about Chrome DevTools. I'm sure most of the people in this room are familiar with DevTools and find it productive in their everyday work. So like the main features are like the Elements panel, the Network panel, the Sources panel. But if you haven't had the chance recently to really go over all of the available options and panels that they have inside of DevTools, I recommend that you do so, because they're always adding newer panels, especially to that bottom panel section over there. And there might be a new use case that you didn't realize that DevTools can solve for you. Now, the interesting thing to note about DevTools is that even though it looks like an integral part of Chrome, it has that gray UI just like the rest of Chrome, it's actually written with a completely different technology stack. So DevTools is just a single-page application written with web technologies, HTML, CSS, JavaScript. Obviously, it's open source, so you can even go in and take a look at the code, and you'll find, as a web developer, you'll find it very readable. The fact that it's just a single-page application, though, has another significance. It means that in order to get the information about the page that you're inspecting, that data has to come from Chrome itself. So the DevTools UI needs to communicate with Chrome in order to get that information. And that's, in fact, how DevTools works. It communicates with Chrome kind of like as a backend server. And they exchange messages over something which we call the DevTools protocol. And let's see how that works. So let's say that you open up your DevTools UI and you go to the console panel and you type in 1+1. So what will happen is that the DevTools UI will compose a message and it will send it across to the Chrome process using WebSockets. So it will be a runtime.evaluate message with 1+1 being the parameter. And then Chrome will calculate this very difficult mathematical conundrum and will return the response. Now, another interesting thing about having this very neat separation between the UI and the backend, obviously it's good for like, you know, clean code and separation of concerns, but it actually has like really good real-life use cases. So what this enables you to do is actually to swap out one of these entities without the other entity knowing that anything changed. And the Node.js team utilized this fact maybe like a year ago. So what they did is, historically, the debugging experience for Node.js applications was pretty bad, but they did see what a nice debugging experience client-side applications had. So by implementing a subset of the DevTools protocol inside of Node, they were able to expose the debugging experience and reutilize the DevTools UI frontend. So if you want to try this yourself, all you have to do is launch a Node script the way you normally do, Node and the name of the script, but you pass in the --- inspect flag. And what you'll get is the familiar DevTools UI, but now inspecting and debugging your server-side code. But obviously, DevTools has other features as well. So just by implementing other parts of the DevTools protocol inside of the Node process, they were able to also offer some of the profiling capabilities that already exist inside of the DevTools UI. So this is called a flame chart. You profile your application, and then it visualizes it in this way. So each one of these bars represents a function call in your application. And the longer the bar is, that means the longer that function took to execute. So it's a nice, really visual way to kind of pinpoint exactly what are the performance bottlenecks of your applications, historically for client-side and now for Node.js as well. But the ability to kind of reuse the DevTools protocol is not used only by Node. Today, you can debug your iOS applications, your Android applications, and even your Internet Explorer applications using the DevTools UI. So we talked about Puppeteer earlier, and we said that it's a high-level wrapper for controlling headless Chrome. But we didn't really say how it's able to do that. So by now, it should be clear that Puppeteer works on this same principle as well. All headless Chrome is doing is listening for DevTools protocol messages. And what Puppeteer is doing is sending those DevTools protocol commands. And the same goes for Chrome driver, the Selenium web driver that's been around for ages to control a regular Chrome. It's also implemented on top of the DevTools protocol. So the takeaway here is this. If you want to automate things in web development, if you want to work with headless browsers, being familiar and being comfortable with tinkering with the DevTools protocol can really help you go a long way. And we'll see an example in a minute. But first, let's see how you even launch Headless Chrome. So this is how you do it. You need to find the Chrome executable on your machine. This is different based on your operating system, of course. And then you need to pass in the headless flag and the remote debugging port. This is the port over which you're going to be sending and receiving DevTools protocol commands. And you can also pass in this URL to load as soon as Headless Chrome launches. Obviously, later you can navigate away using DevTools protocol commands. So let's try this. I'm going to execute this. But before I do, I just want you to think what you expect to happen when I do this. So if you thought absolutely nothing, then yeah, you're correct. It's a headless browser. Nothing is really happening. So I can get started with writing a script that would control the headless browser. But there's already something I can do right now to kind of make sure that everything is working as expected. I can go over that same port over HTTP. Oh, no, sorry. What's happening? That's weird. OK, let's try that. Just a sec. Maybe Wi-Fi. OK, here we go. So I told Headless Chrome to launch the RenderConf website as soon as I launch Headless Chrome. And you see I have a link here that says RenderConf. Now, again, I want you to think what you expect to see when I click this. So if you're thinking, well, the RenderConf website, that's not it. But if you thought DevTools, then yeah, you're correct. So the browser I'm using here is not Headless Chrome. That's just a browser on my machine. And again, because Headless Chrome is expecting DevTools protocol commands, it's already exposing the DevTools UI, which is obviously a really convenient way to send DevTools protocol commands. So this is just your standard DevTools. But what is unique, because I'm inspecting a remote instance of Chrome, is I have this toggle screencast button here. And when I click this, I can actually see a live preview of what's rendered inside of Headless Chrome. And I can even interact with it. So I can scroll, I can click things. But everything that I'm doing here is just serialized, sent across to the Headless Chrome instance, and I'm getting back a live preview. So let's think about everything that we learned about the DevTools protocol and how it can help us solve these other use cases ourselves. So the example that we're going to use to illustrate this, so let's say that we now took the time to implement a feature that's going to make our site faster. So let's say that we're clearing out, we're doing like a spring cleaning for all the unused CSS that I have in my application. So let's say that back in the day we were using Bootstrap and we hardly ever use it anymore, but we're still sending down the entire Bootstrap CSS library to the client. It's obviously a big performance overhead, and just by getting rid of it, we're going to make our application faster. But we don't only want to do that, we also want to write a test for it. So that if somebody accidentally reverts this, if somebody deletes a big feature without deleting the associated CSS, then he's going to get that immediate alert. So the first step in order to write that kind of test is to understand that DevTools can help us find the amount of unused CSS in your application. So you might not be familiar with it because it's hidden here under these bottom panels. You have the coverage panel here. I'm actually going to show this with a different website for a conference that I'm launching next year to compete with RenderConf. As you can see, I nailed it. So once you click this Start Recording button, it will tell you right now that 54% of the CSS for this page is unused. And you might think, OK, this is like an outrageous number, right? Because more than half of the CSS that I'm sending down for this website is unused. But I didn't really interact with the page. And obviously, I'm sending down more CSS than I would need after the page is loaded. After the user interacts with my application, you can see this number starts to go down because this is doing like a live recording. And after I've completed all the interactions that I can do in this particular application, it drops down to 14% unused CSS. So this is the number that I really want to measure. And this is what I'm going to use to set my threshold. So let's say that if this crosses 15%, I want to have the continuous integration server break, a Slack message, or anything of that nature. So we know that DevTools can do this via the UI. So we also know for sure, because of our understanding of how DevTools works now, is that you can also do this from an automated script using the DevTools protocol. So all we need to do is to figure out what are the DevTools protocol commands that are being sent out when you start and stop the recording. So how can we figure that out? Well, we know that the DevTools is just a web application, so we do what we do whenever we want to understand how a web application works, and that's use DevTools. So now I have DevTools running on the bottom, inspecting the web application at the top, which just happens to be DevTools inspecting what's happening inside of Headless Chrome. And if I refresh this, we said earlier that DevTools communicates over WebSockets. So here at the bottom, I'm using the network panel and the WebSockets filter. And I can actually see the raw DevTools protocol commands that are being sent over. So all I have to do now is start the coverage tracking, stop the coverage tracking. And I can see that the command that's being sent out when I start the coverage tracking is css.start rule usage tracking. And the command that stops it is css stop rule usage tracking. Now that I have this information, I can get started with writing my script. So this is how we're going to do it. Again, we're using Puppeteer. But now we're going to send raw DevTools protocol commands using Puppeteer. So Puppeteer.launch and browser new page. Now, in order to send raw DevTools protocol commands, we're going to use the client property. And we're going to use its send method to send those raw commands. We saw that the command that I want to send is css.start rule usage tracking. Well, that means that the domain for that subset of the DevTools protocol is the CSS domain. So I have to enable that domain first. And some domains are dependent on other domains. This is an implementation detail that you need to be aware of. But if you don't get it right, you'll get a nice friendly error message back. So don't worry too much about it. So now I'm going to start rule usage tracking, start monitoring the CSS coverage. What this will eventually give me when I stop the tracking is going to give me an array of ranges inside of my style sheets of selectors in my CSS that were used. So if I want to set this up as a ratio between the amount used and the total amount, then I need to get the total amount as well. In order to get the total amount of each CSS file or each style sheet, I'm going to add an event handler for whenever a new style sheet is added. And every time that's called, that's going to contain the information about what's the total size of that style sheet. So for now, I'm just storing that in an array. Then I'm going to go to whatever page it is that I want to run this test for. And in order to get that final number after all the interaction with the page, I'm also going to simulate all the user actions that the user can do. In this case, it's pretty straightforward. It's just clicking on each one of those tabs in my amazing conference website. Then I can call stop rule usage tracking, and what I'll get back is that rule usage object, which, like I said, contains all the selectors that were used. Now I just want to present this as a nice percentage rounded up to the nearest integer. So I do that in a function that I don't show here called calculate unused CSS. But it's not touching Headless Chrome or anything like that. It's just a primary school level math, so very tedious. I'll have a link at the end where you can find the complete implementation. Then I can log it out and close my browser. So let's see this in action. If I execute this, it'll tell me 14% of your CSS is unused. And if, for example, I comment out these lines that tell it to interact with each of the tabs, it will tell me 54% of your CSS is unused. So I put together this page with links on getting started with Headless Chrome and Puppeteer and tinkering with the DevTools protocol and all the examples shown here today. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out later in the conference or on Twitter. Thank you very much.